So why does a person that lives next to the biggest racetrack in Europe, the Nürburgring, travels all the way to the UK to do Brands Hatch and especially the Indy circuit? Because Brands Hatch Indy is a fantastic place. And maybe the onboard fails a little bit to translate what makes it unique. So let's break it down in a few small pieces. First of all, the history. Brands is of course an ex-F1 circuit. And as many other circuits that we discussed, ex-F1 being the key. If that was to be converted to a modern F1 standards, it would probably not be the racetrack that it is today. However, for me, the most important thing has been all these cool touring car races that have happened there through the years, BTCC, WTCC. Seeing all these cars storm together to Paddock Hill is an image that I had engraved in my memory growing up. And of course, I wanted to do that one corner in my own car. And again, we are talking about one special corner and if it makes sense to travel to a circuit to do that one corner. And I guarantee you it does. And we are going to see why Paddock Hill by itself is a reason to visit Brands Hatch Indy. And it's now a good time to explain to you how this circuit fits in my whole UK trip. One of the reasons that this trip was possible was Manos. He actually offered me a place to store the car and stay with him. And even joined me in different tracks to help me film. Brands Hatch wasn't one of the tracks that he joined me filming because he was actually busy on another shoot, but still, that meant that my base while I was in the UK was an area close to Manchester. That meant that I drove almost 300 kilometers from Manchester to London just to do one small afternoon session and then 300 kilometers back, which proved to be quite eventful, and I almost saw my car being destroyed, but that is secondary. Let's stick to the track stuff. Maybe I should say that although the whole facility is fantastic, especially for the size of the track, it's actually quite a modern facility, entering the track is quite tricky. So it's one of the very few tracks, if not the only one track, that I arrived there and I was almost lost. I was very lucky because Tim, one of the people that actually followed this channel and has spoken with us through the years, was there. He sent me a message when he realized that I was going to Brands Hatch and he offered himself to show me a little bit around and to show me the track. Something that I took him up later on and I went for a few laps with him. So basically, I arrived there, quite a few cars, a short session. I had no one to help me film, so basically I was not really sure how we were really gonna do it. And my only goal was to do Paddock Hill, you know, to take a small taste of that cool corner, then do a few laps and call it a day. I didn't want to push the car too much because there was a track day in Cadwell coming and that was like my main thing. However, the moment I got on track, the moment I actually drove the Indy circuit, I actually felt that there was something special. And even before, when I went for a passenger lap with Tim, I actually felt that this track has something. I should have known better because there is a reason why all these tracks have this reputation, but being able to find it out myself and see what speaks to me was particularly cool. So let's see the circuit. The circuit is very, very small. This bean-shaped thing, it doesn't look like anything special, especially when you look at the track map from the top. It looks like a very boring thing, but it's actually the topography of the place, and it's all these elevation changes, all these dips and the hills and all these cool 3D elements that make this track unique and make this simple almost design come alive. So yes, Paddock Hill is the thing, Paddock Hill is the highlight, but Paddock Hill is a very tricky corner for multiple reasons. First of all, the braking zone is very tricky because here, following the tradition of other great tracks, the straight is not straight. It's curved and it's going up and down. So basically, as you approach the braking zone for Paddock Hill, it's a quite strange thing because already before even the corner starts, the track actually turns a little bit. So you shouldn't find yourself too much on the left. I never really did the straight at full speed, and I will explain to you why. But basically, having all this gradient there is what actually makes the corner come alive. Having the car loaded there, finding the extra grip from the compression, and powering the car out all the way to the curb. I basically had like one lap that I sort of did it fast, and I found myself with a tiny bit of counter at the exit, two wheels at the curb, and I said, okay, cool, I'm happy. My visit here is done, and that is that. So yes, very tricky corner, but the cool thing is that everything that follows after is again very interesting. So Druids is basically your typical hairpin, only that it isn't, because normally you would tackle Druids and any corner that looks like this, basically as a late apex corner, but it's a little bit the opposite. I think the conventional wisdom is that you should stay tight and try to stay on the inside and not really do the meters on the outside, and that's the faster way to do this. And remember, because the track is so short, every little bit counts. And then you come all the way down for the Graham Hill bend. It's a fast corner. It's a little bit tricky because the car kind of wants to move like in the middle of it. And it is extra important because the only other straight, sort of straight that exists in the track is the Cooper Straight here. And again, in such a short track, you want to maximize your entry to these corners that actually leads you to these small straights. So basically, quite a bit of speed to be gained there. And what comes after, which is, feels almost instant, especially in a car that has a little bit of power, like my MX-7, you basically, before you even know it, you are there, you're in the next corner. And here, Surtees is actually a very cool left-hander. Some people might, especially looking at the bend, you might think that Surtees and McLaren is like an S-bend, you know, and you have like the last corner there, that is also actually two corners, but it's not really true. In my head, I would break it down a little bit like this. You sort of try to do Surtees as fast as you can, because it is a very crucial. In a way, you kind of ignore McLaren, because what you want to do is you want to prepare your braking zone, your braking point, for clearways, for the last corner of the track. And I think if you do everything right, by the exit of clearways, Clark curve is a little bit secondary. Not really secondary, but you understand what I mean. It's not as crucial for the lap. So basically, doing Surtees fast and try to find your braking zone for clearways is what you want to do. And I would say that clearways by itself is a very confusing place because you don't really have reference points, the track turns a million times, and you don't really want to find yourself completely on the left. The curb starts small on the inside and then it gets bigger. That sort of transition is, in a way, your apex is the point that you want to aim towards. And then if you do this, if you just focus on braking as hard as you can and as late as you can, and then you try to turn in there and you hit that turn in, you sort of navigated that complex. And then the tricky part is getting on the accelerator as soon as you can. There is always a bit of understeer. My car didn't really want to turn in, but it is very crucial to try to turn in with as much speed as possible and go on the power hard. This is something that I couldn't do. So going on the power hard was not possible. And you probably saw in the onboard that I'm actually going for third, fourth, fifth, like literally in a few meters. And the reason is that Brands Hatch has a very strict sound limit, and I actually triggered it straight on the first lap, which actually meant that any possibility of doing a fast lap around Brands that afternoon was actually scrapped.
Was this for us, you think? Yeah. Was it for noise?
Oh. Yeah,
I'm on the
road. Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
Did we do something bad?
You selfed the drive-by by about 8 to 9 dBs. So very, very loud.
So the laps that you see are not really representative of what the car could do. But even with this issue, not being able to be flat out in the last corner of the track, that is very important, I still had a fucking blast. You might have noticed that I did this by myself with no guest to give some extra knowledge, some extra insight. However, I have a recommendation to make. There's a YouTube channel called Driver 61, run by Scott Mansell. It's a fantastic channel for people that want to understand how driving works. And they have a Branch Hatch Indie guide that I will actually put in the link below. Normally, the majority of things that you find online is people speaking about things they have no clue about. Contrary to this, Driver 61 and Scott Mansell actually know what they're talking about. He's the fastest guy to ever lap Branch Hatch in the circuit in an F1 car. So you're learning from someone that not only knows what he's talking about, but he has been out there and done it. That wraps the whole experience of driving Branch Indy. A fantastic thing. If you ever told me that a 1 minute lap could be so cool, I would not believe you. Where I grew up, our local racetrack was actually very small, like 2 kilometers or something, like a 1 minute, 1 minute, 10 lap. And basically, I always yearned to go to all these cool places with huge tracks, Spa, the Ring, all these big 5, 6, 7, 20 kilometer tracks. And I think in a way I have completely pushed aside any small track. And that is a big mistake. I honestly had as much fun in these afternoon sunset sessions, you know, as I had in some of the big proper tracks. And that might be proof in a way of how we at One Lap Heroes approach driving. Normally, when you go at a place and you cannot really do that fast lap that you want to do, you sort of scrap the day and you say, okay, nothing's gonna happen today. I'm not gonna do this fast lap that I want. I'm triggering the sound meters. There is too much traffic. I cannot do my perfect lap. So this day is wasted. And many people think like this, and it is a way to approach it. We don't really judge it. However, I think sometimes it's good to travel away from your local track, go to a new place, take a new challenge, drive for the fun of driving and have a blast, which is exactly what I did. Next one is Caldwell Park, so no excuses. We are there to go and drive the track. We are there to go fast. We are there to enjoy it to the fullest. So I highly recommend you subscribe, hit this notification thing so you can actually see when the next video is dropped. Caldwell is not gonna disappoint. And see you in the next one.